With that, ladies and gentlemen, we are quickly diving into our first panel discussion for the day, where our speakers are joining from different brands, agencies to discuss the role of omnichannel targeting to build effective brand connections in this multi-screening world. So I hope all of you are ready and excited for this as we are to bring our speakers on the screen. But before that, let me once again remind all of you, you can send in your questions for our panelists, which we will take at the end of the discussion. At the same time, do not forget to tweet using our hashtag IndiaBrandEnclave. Moving forward, I'd like to invite our speakers and panelists for this session. Inviting on screen, Ms. Bhavna Mittal, Head of Media and Digital RP Sanjeev Goenka Group. Mr. Bharat.
Hi.
Hi, very warm welcome, Bhavna. We also have with us on the panel, Mr. Bharat Khatri, Country Lead, Zaxis India.
Hey, Kathy, hi.
Hi, welcome, sir. We also have with us on the panel, Ms. Chanan Sawhney, Head Digital Marketing and Media, Johnson & Johnson. Very warm welcome to you.
Hi, everybody.
We also have with us on the panel, Ms. Preeti Murthy, CEO, OMD.
Hello, everyone.
On the panel, we also have Mr. Pavan Sarda, Group Head, Digital Marketing and E-Commerce Future Group.
Hi, everyone.
And last but not the least, our panelist, Mr. Rajiv Dhal, Chief Revenue Officer, Z5. Welcome, sir.
It's a pretty big panel.
And to share this session, we have with us Mr. Anuj Kumar, Co-Founder, Chief Revenue and Operating Officer, Affle. A very warm welcome to you, Mr. Kumar.
Hi.
And I'm going to give the screen to you to take the proceedings forward.
Perfect. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining. I hope you can hear me well.
Yes.
Perfect. So I think we have a fairly big panel and a very interesting topic and a short time to discuss it. So I think we'll get on with it. I think I'll just recap for all the viewers in terms of what we are discussing today. I think the topic is very, very relevant for our times today, which is around the role of omnichannel targeting to build effective brand connections. And I think if you look at it today, I think in a world where the online and offline personas of users were largely different earlier, I think we have today reached a stage that whatever we are doing, we are digitally connected. So even if we are in a shop, we are carrying our mobile devices, we are carrying our watches. So clearly for a brand who's communicating, you need to be always on. And that is where the challenge has grown a lot today. And I think that's where the importance of omnichannel targeting, given the number of connected devices each one of us is using, becomes super important. And I think that's where the topic is very, very interesting. And I think we have a great panel here. I think we've got folks within the group here who are more from the marketing side and representing that side of the world. We've got agencies, trading desks, and also the OTTs. So I think we've got a fairly star-studded panel, and we can get off started quickly with taking some of your views on things which I think will be very relevant for all to understand about this topic. So I think without much ado, maybe I'll take first, take the people who are largely wearing the marketing hat here and pose a question both to Bhavna and Chanan. And Bhavna, over to you first. So I think I'm sure you're running marketing for a company which has got a lot of offline brands and also nowadays also some online brands. And for a consumer, the online-offline experience has largely blended. Now, sure. Around what you're doing right now for marketing for your brand, I think what we would want, what I would want you to talk more about is any interesting initiative which you have done which is largely blending the online-offline journey of customers, or anything interesting which you have seen any other brands in the industry do. So I think feel free to talk about what you have done, make it a plug for yourself, or for anybody else, any other Indian or international advertiser you've seen this doing well.
Right. Thank you, Anuj. Thanks again to get me to be a part of this panel. It's nice to see all the friends and folks you know around the industry in here. So given that I work for a fairly large group, thankfully, I don't have to look too far for examples. And we have enough and more within the group as well. And I would actually take up the case of Spencer's Retail right now, and Spencer's is one of India's first hypermarket stores which came about, and we kind of got organized retail into the country. It became a part of the group later on, but during this COVID times, it was pretty testing, and it was something which we realized that we need to really amp up our game on the omnichannel front. So what we actually did was that we do have an app, and there are about 200 stores across the country, but during the time of COVID, you really didn't know how people were reacting. There was a lot of hue and cry about goods not being available, and of course, the lockdown was making things difficult for all of us. So what we got on to doing was that, yes, there is an app. So one was that the app was kind of given more importance than the stores at that time, because a lot of us actually started doing most of our shopping online. And then there was a store which was like a store-in-store created with Flipkart as well, where the consumers could actually go and figure out what are the kind of grocery needs they have, and those could be fulfilled by Spencer's in their city. On top of that, we also got on tying up with various delivery service providers like a Uber or a Swiggy or a Rapido, basis the market which we were in. And actually, you know, just to make sure that the last mile of delivery was also taken care of, because earlier the delivery requirements from our stores was fairly limited, but given again the COVID situation, that was something which people were looking forward to. People were scared to step out of the houses, and that helped us. So it kind of seamlessly brought in the whole experience for the consumer in terms of getting their at least the grocery and other related needs, whichever are the products available at Spencer's. Those were pretty much sorted, and you don't really have to think too much about it. And I mean, I will not share the actual numbers, but from a single digit, we actually got onto a double digit growth during that time from these channels.
Very interesting. I think I'm a big consumer and buyer from Spencer's. I wish I had known it in the COVID days. I would have definitely gone in and experienced it online and ensured that I could continue to be a consumer. But very, very nice. Mm-hmm. I think moving on to Chanan, I think I hope I'm pronouncing your name correctly.
It's Chanan.
Okay, so sorry. So Chanan, over to you. Same question. You can choose it from your own journey of building the Johnson & Johnson various brands within J&J, or any other brands outside which you have seen who have blended the online and offline world pretty seamlessly.
So I'll take a quick stab at both. So okay. For us, I think, one of our portfolios is premium beauty. So we have a brand called Neutrogena, which is quite a cult status in itself for the consumers that it caters to. So, we speak a lot about giving the right experience that comes around it. So skin, your regime, your what suits your skin, what doesn't. So there is a lot of advice that is provided by the brand through the science it has of about the skin and efforts, and that's somehow given online. But the demos that are done in the store, the sales assistants who are trained on it in the store to answer the query. So there's a lot of and beauty brands you'll see have a lot of clutter online from the kind of experience they build, but also the information they give. So from search all the way to the website to the Instagram, the experience is seamless, which is a lot more about the brand. And when you go to the store, you can actually test the product, and you'll have a very, very similar experience. And that's at least what we try to account for. And that's one of the things that we are trying to do more and more of, through whether you look at a lot of usage of technology which goes into stores, etc., so that your experience is more or less seamless. And the brand that I am genuinely inspired on an omnichannel this thing is Starbucks. I think the way you enter a store, and somehow if you're not carrying cash, you can just open your app. By the time you reach the counter, the guy already knows what's your regular order. He's already swiped you for money. It's like a quick in, quick out. Then the loyalty application works so beautifully. So I think that's just maybe it's just me, but I'm a huge fan.
Perfect. Very, very insightful. And for the Neutrogena and the premium beauty, what you describe it, are you also looking at doing things which are getting people to see the ads online and then being incentivized to walk to the offline yes. stores where they can experience it?
Yes, very much. So you could ask a question, get okay. a response, and then go offline and buy. You could actually see the ad. You could see the launch of a product and then go offline and buy. You could see something offline and bring back your query and buy online. So that's how we are trying to build it out.
Perfect. Very, very nice. I think from there, I'll move into another person on this panel who's obviously representing a retail company, also leading e-commerce there. So over to you, Pawan. And I'm sure when you are doing marketing for your brands, hi, Pawan, good to have you here. So I think my question to you is that I'm sure that today when you are doing marketing for your brands, at one end, you are competing with the other retail-first brands. But from a normal consumer's point of view, you are also competing with the online-first companies. And the online first companies obviously have a great advantage where their entire marketing is very, very data led because they know a lot around what consumers are buying, what they might be interested in. How do you combat that challenge for marketing digitally for a company which is still largely more offline retail?
Yeah. Hi, Anuj. Good to have you. To be here. Thank you, everyone. So I'm going to try and answer this in two parts. First, I would still pick the entire idea of omnichannel. I think that's the subject of discussion today. I've been hearing this term for over 4 to 5 years, but I think COVID has finally made it true. I think finally the omnichannel has come. It's made businesses think through in terms of how the online and offline both needs to be merging together at the supply side and demand side both, right? And that's why I want to address the supply side as well before getting into the demand side, right? I think one big thing which we learned as retailers and all of us and obviously I think we had bits and pieces of e-commerce, but really if I have to speak the truth, I think the e-commerce was actually competing with the offline retail. And that's where I don't think it could see the light of the day the way it should have been, right? But I think the moment COVID came in, the first thing I think what we did was integrating our supply side, right? So, just imagine when you run an e-commerce business and your stores become literally a supply chain partner in that sense. Look at the scope and what it can do. So I think that's one big advantage which we got and finally accepted, right? And how each of these stores or each of the touch points can literally play the role of supply chain, right? I think some of our brands businesses like plus size business like All Online literally got a huge merit out of this, right? We have EBOs and almost close to 100 EBOs, and we literally made them each one of them as a supply chain last mile partner in that sense, and it kind of gave us a huge amount of benefit. So I think that's one part, omnichannel literally coming to the life of business. The other part is the demand side, right? Obviously, when you look at demand side. Obviously, when you're running an e-commerce business, it's seamless, right? You acquire a customer and you can create, literally convert the customer and you can get to know the journey pretty well. And the moment you recruit that customer online, offline, it becomes a little tough, right? You don't know what has happened in spite of whatever integration which you do with some of these partners. Right. So I think we were early enough to kind of understand this, and we run online to offline. One of the biggest campaign which we actually run is with Google, where whether anybody's any customer who's kind of looking for you, I assume that he is literally our 50% of our customer. The intent is almost 50% to go and buy. So we do a lot of couponing with that. So then what happens is we get to know the last mile transaction in the basket. We also know that what kind of customers actually coming to us, and what is the larger intent based. And we've kind of used it not just on Google but also on social media platforms. So I think these are the two sides which I see. But omnichannel has come to life. We all have to accept it. That's the new reality. It's really not about competing with each other. I think that's the biggest one which we have learned. And yes, and there's a huge advantage to it.
Do you feel handicapped sometimes given you're competing with the online companies who pretty much know my entire journey so much better than any offline company could do?
Yeah, 100%. I mean, there's no doubt
marketing
about it. There is no doubt about it. You know, unfortunately, since Rajiv is also here, so let me put it out. But, you know, there are no products for offline if you look at it. These are some tacky ways of creating it. I wish, whether it's social media or Z5, they all need to bring in this for offline as well. I don't know of many of them, but I think that's a great need, right? I mean, that's the big advantage of online. You can really catch the customer. You know that this customer has come to the cart and not shop. So let me remarket and ensure he comes back, right? There's so many things which you can do. Offline, I still don't know if there are any great products from any of the platforms.
I'm sure there are many platforms listening to you here. And
yes,
you might be bombarded on LinkedIn or email on some of their solutions.
So I think omni-channel, we are experiencing right. In a very unique manner. So it's not really real world versus digital world. It's more of multi-screening. So today people are consuming content across all three screens in a very seamless manner. And that's created a unique challenge as well. And so like on Z5, we allow 5 concurrent usage for SWOT. So not only 5 profiles, but 5 concurrent users. And we also get to know that there are platforms like on OLX, people are trading concurrent connections for a small price as well. But that's we'll let that happen for a while.
The good part is
that people are watching, starting to discover on mobile, easy discovery, quick discovery, moving on to maybe a laptop if you're working. And I've personally also experienced so many of our friends, I think everybody on the panel must be switching between all three and then move
Absolutely.
On. So as we speak with Apple and with one of their companies that exist in UK, we are trying to figure out a way by which even build some, Anuj, I was just trying to fill in the gap till the time you come back, but I was just sharing our experience on multi-screening. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to build an attribution model wherein if I see communication on connected TV and it's followed on mobile because there are more occasions to target you on mobile in maybe multiple contexts which cannot happen on TV. And then if you end up visiting a place, so we're trying to build a linkage between all three. So I see future group communication on connected TV, I am followed up with a specific recommendation based on my likes and dislikes on my mobile. And then I end up visiting a store or ordering through some other channel, maybe Swiggy Genie or someone. So we're trying to work in that area. It's early days, but soon we'll reach there. So that's our experience of multi-screening. Anuj, are you back? No problem. I think,
yes, I'm back. I mean,
you want to come in and share your
multi-screening way?
Yeah.
I'm now joined from my mobile phone, so it's truly multi-screening that my PC came up on the last minute.
That's okay.
So that's
thank God for mobile phones,
good.
Right?
So good. I guess the discussion.
So
was
can I add to what Rajiv and Pawan?
Yeah, please.
Yes, Anuj. So can I add to what Rajiv and Pawan were speaking? So, you know, Pawan, for me, what was interesting was platforms like Trell, the Indian-born social commerce platforms that are actually creating this space. Now, these are very, very nascent, very, very early stages, but getting 50 million base for them seems to be a no-brainer. You know, there are so many platforms like that, SimSim. So the social commerce bit is kind of coming in quite early for us and catching up very fast. Yes, but is it fully integrated to the back end from the offline business? So, you know, that omni-channel seamless integration is, I think, the key to success of scaling up for all these platforms as well. And I think that's where the interesting turn of events, I think, in the next 2 years, at least, which I see happening in the market for
integrating first party, second party, third party data coming in beautifully then. And that's where it'll work smoothly as well. So I'm with you on that part. Over to you, Anuj.
Yep. And in terms of the data, now, obviously you see many platforms which you might be working with where data is not really owned by the advertiser and it would be more owned by the platform. As an agency, how do you tackle that and how important is owning the data either from an agency lens or even from an advertiser lens for you to make a decision to work with a platform versus the other?
I think, like I mentioned just now, that the first party, second party, third party, how does it all come together? And yeah. I think there are different type of advertisers, some who have very rich first party data, whom we are going to mine it beautifully with a second party audience set. So I can work directly with these second party players and then get it done. Or I get in and work directly with a third party. But at the same breath, we have players who are in the initial stage of their offering or their transformation journey. And we actually heavily relied on the mass and the third party data and the walled garden data sometimes also, because we have to depend on those platforms to drive the efficiency for you. I think as agencies, I have my view as this. Yes, we need to partner with the clients to own the data at their end too and strengthen the first party. At the same breath, we need to, like what we do successfully with platforms like Omni, where there's a plug and play bot platform, which allows like any app to be downloaded and displayed and work along and then deleted later. But the core of the platform lies with the agency. I think that's what is giving us empowerment to work with data seamlessly and allowing for the confidentiality of the client, because that's of supreme importance. Because if they're going to share the first party data and integrate it with platforms, it can either reside with us or with them. And we need to ensure there is a seamless transition there. And I think most agencies would be creating their own backend and to ensure that the privacy is maintained. And I think platforms like Omni's uniqueness is that it is protected, it is plug and play, and it is customized to the client typology also. So that's how I see it.
No, I think that's very, very helpful. I think on that note, I'll move into you, Bharat. You're obviously also at Zaxis, working with most of the top programmatic and data-driven companies, and I'm sure you're seeing similar challenges. Now, how is it that, because you have multitude of brands which within the WPP portfolio, you would be looking at some which are online first, some which are offline driven brands. How are you working on unifying audience personas based on what they're doing online and what they might be doing offline?
So I think rightly said on the panel, when it is about D2C brands, there is a lot of information which is already about the consumer, what the brand has as first party. And it's very easy and seamless to integrate that sort of proxies about consumer, whether you are working within a walled garden or an open web environment. And you can definitely choose the channel, like Rajiv mentioned, whether you want to advertise and message on a mobile device or a desktop or a connected TV. And the way the new devices are getting onboarded on programmatic, like digital out of home, digital audio, yes. I think it's becoming more seamless for us to build an omni-channel campaign, which is about engaging with the same customer with different messaging on a different platform, understanding what content they're browsing. But when it comes to the brick and mortar, primarily, I would say, let's say, some of the brands within the FMCG vertical, where it is still a challenge for them to understand about their consumer, I think there are new proxies which are developing. And one of the proxies, I think, which most of our client portfolio used quite significantly during this COVID war, they were able to map the data point of pre-COVID offline retail sales. So there are a lot of companies in India who collect the POS retail store data. Using that, they were able to map at which pin code, what type of SKUs and product category are being sold. Using that information from offline, we were able to map it on the online targeting when we were driving a consumer from top funnel to the bottom funnel. We realized which pin codes are the sweet spot or the low-hanging fruit. Because pre-COVID, the pin code already was showing more than average sales consumption of that particular product. So during COVID, if people are not going out and buying the product from the retail store and they will be shopping on e-com, how can we tap these customers
both on the walled garden environment as well as on open web, so that we can drive meaningful, relevant traffic to the brand e-commerce page. And similarly, I think within the retail portfolio, we all realized when we moved into the unlockdown situation, there was enough pressure from all the retail brands to bring the consumer back to the store. So interestingly, I think within the omni-channel, there is something which I think we didn't discuss on the panel is all about the creative messaging. A lot of times we might see brands trying to do an omni-channel campaign, but the CTA within the creative messaging is not asking people to visit to a store or take a certain action online. So I think from a creative lens, the way the new tools and technologies are coming on the programmatic space, specifically around the use of AI, I think the creative copies that the AI is able to create and generate on the go, on the fly, is actually driving more meaningful omni-channel campaigns versus the managed format in which we take certain types of research and predict how the consumer is going to behave.
Perfect. I think that's very, very helpful, Bharat, and I think something which I'm sure many brands across are looking at doing right now. I think on that point, I'll jump to you, Rajiv. I'm sure that as an leading OTT company, omni-channel, multi-screening to you means something else. Multi-screening for you is obviously how your content is being consumed across multiple screens. And within the last few months, especially in the pandemic era, I think a lot of growth we have seen in areas like connected TV. How have you seen that impacting your business, and what are the trends you are foreseeing on connected TV advertising over the next few years? And maybe I'll look for a short answer because I know you can have many, many things there. It's an area which is quite close to your heart.
No, no, you're absolutely right. So I'll wrap up very quickly, though I covered a little bit earlier while you're trying to reconnect. So basically, I was just saying that we've experienced people now consuming our content on three platforms in a single session. When I'm calling as a session, it's like within a gap of 2-3 hours. They discover content on first screen, which is mobile in most of the cases. There have been instances they move on to either a tablet or a laptop or a desktop, which is more like a slightly larger screen. And as we all know, most of the people are working from home. So we know that it's also colored by the COVID scenario that we have right now. And we don't know whether that'll continue, but we believe that multi-screening will continue. And they finally move on to large screen as well. It completely depends on the type of content. We have noticed that if the type of content is high quality, which is the depth is much higher, like a Bhai kind of content, people do want to watch on live stream. Whereas if the content is easy to consume, they continue on a mobile device. So that's multi-screening for us. Connected TV, no debate, no doubt. I think we did a discussion a couple of weeks back. Bharat was also part of the discussion. And the conclusion was, in 2 years, in India, if all goes well, and if Reliance and Airtel continue to do what they're trying to do, 50% in urban India would have converted to connected TV. Now, that's huge. Imagine. So today, we have 50 to 60 live TV channels, news channels. Now, we do offer replacement of ad pod with a targeted ad pod, but to be very honest, it's very small on scale. When I say very small, it's not in 50 million or it's not in that kind of a size. But once connected TV becomes 50%, imagine we will be replacing linear TV ad pod with very targeted ads. And that's where the element of excitement would come in. That's when we will be able to tell Pawan that when he advertised on ZTV and Z5, how many people finally walked into featured brick stores and converted into maybe buying something. So I think everybody's working towards also solving the issue of the issue, which is today we don't know attribution, how to really conclude what worked and what didn't work. And yep. Anush, at this point, also trying to work with one of your companies to solve one piece of this puzzle. So, yeah, so there's a lot of excitement. There's a lot of good fun. Everything which is home consumption is on a rise. Multi-screening and multi-screening for us, and multi-channel or omni-channel approach for retail is there forever. I don't think it's going to turn back. I don't think people, if any habit that's followed for 21 days, it becomes part of your life. Now we've done it for 9 months. So I don't think much is going to change. I don't think so. I'm in office right now. Having said that, this is my 8th visit in 8 months. So that's going to be the future reality. So over to you.
Yep. No, I think very, very interesting. I think very good to hear the kind of trends you're seeing on CTV. I think personally, I've been a big believer on that. And I think the last few months have only accelerated how consumers have adapted to this new screen for consuming digital content and pretty much replacing their linear TV consumption. So I think very, very interesting things. I think we've had a good time with everybody sharing their points of views on different parts of the topic. I think we have only a few minutes, given that we started a bit late. I think I have an interesting round planned right now, which is more a rapid fire, which I want to conduct with all of you. So I think, as you might have been guessing, I think a rapid fire is largely where I'll be throwing quick questions to each of the panelists, and it could be a one word answer or maybe in some cases greater. And I think I hope it'll be fun and interesting for all of you, and also for all the people who've tuned in and watching our telecast right now. Yeah. So if everybody is good, we can quickly roll on to that. Any volunteers of who wants to go first for the rapid fire? And I promise that the winner for the rapid fire, I think we've seen that there is always a winner who wins something. So I think all our cherished dreams of winning the coffee hamper might come true now. So go for it and have a good rapid fire round. And I need volunteers of who would go first.
I think we can go alphabetically.
Rajiv, as it was your suggestion to go alphabetically, I think we'll go reverse alphabetically and start.
Yeah, sure. That's a good one. Sure. You can start.
Yeah. So then otherwise, alphabetically, I'm sure it's helped you in school where you always ended up being the last. Now we have reversed the alphabets.
No, absolutely.
Yeah, so looking for quick answers on each of these questions. Some are fun, some are interesting. So I think, Rajiv, over to you. First question. Advertising on ZTV or Z5, what's better for digitally first brands?
100%, the answer is Z5. Though the revenue is right now skewed on ZTV, but the answer obviously is going to be Z5. But now we have an integrated approach, so it'll be ZTV and Z5.
Interesting. I hope your teams are watching this. 2022, what percentage of OTT viewers do you expect coming from CTV?
Is this to me or?
Yeah, this is to you. You have a few questions, okay. Rajiv. So, 4 or 5 will come to you.
Yeah. So right now, approximately 10 to 12% of our users are already coming via connected TV. And we definitely believe it will be 3x of what it is right now. We believe we should be anywhere between 20 to 30 million by next year.
Cool. So Rajiv's answer is 35 to 40% connected TV out of all OTT. My personal guesstimate is actually much higher, but we'll leave it there. Next question, Rajiv, to you. Meeting revenue targets in an OTT company or a language content company, which one has been easier for you?
OTT. I think time.
Many who are interesting with you are also there on this panel. Guys, make it difficult for Rajiv next time. Digital will be 50% of India's adex by when?
2026.
Long way to go. Could be faster if we don't solve the pandemic sooner. Okay, last question to you, Rajiv. Connected cross-screen experiences for advertisers on video or isolated CTV, mobile, and PC advertising strategies? What do you think works better?
100% the first one. It has to be multi-screen, so it has to move around. So, option one.
Perfect. So, looking forward to more connected ones coming up. So, that's your round, Rajiv. And politically correct answers other than the first one, which is ZTV versus Z5, which I'm sure put you in a spot. But we'll move in reverse alphabetical, and I guess now is Pawan.
So over to you, Pavan. I'll throw in my questions.
Yeah.
Drive to store or drive to app? What's the ideal strategy for retail businesses?
Store, because I think offline retail is still very, very large in India. It's still close to 85-86%, always.
Cool. Online retail as a percentage of all retail by 23, what do you feel? What percentage would be online retail?
I don't think it's going to exceed more than 20%.
Okay. I'm sure if we had an Amazon panelist on this group, the answers could have been dramatically different.
Yeah, but you know, even in US, let's look at a very mature market. Like what, how much is it? It's 10%, 12%? I don't think so. I mean, sorry, 20% is a lot. Sorry, I correct my number. It's not going to be more than 5%. Sorry.
Okay, cool. Take that as an answer. Drive to store measurement for all digital campaigns which you do. Is this ideal or not?
Absolutely ideal.
Absolutely ideal. Next one. Now, for the e-commerce companies, we've seen that most of the e-commerce companies have become big advertising companies with Amazon ads, Flipkart ads, etc. When do we see Future Group becoming Future Ads with offline habits of what consumers are buying?
You know, again, it's a phase. If you look at like 10 to 15 years back, I mean, we were doing exactly the same what online is doing. See, I personally feel that, you know, right now we are at a stage where it's about really bringing in to the country and really changing the habit, right? So I think each one of them will take their own pattern in that sense. And as industry matured, you'll see something else coming out.
Cool. Thanks so much. Good answers. We are running short on time. So I'll move in quickly to Preeti. The spotlight is on you. Now, first question, Preeti. Agencies having their own DMP and audience intelligence or using multiple DMPs? What is the ideal route?
See, the market is evolving. Ideally, the question to me itself is fundamentally shaky because there's nothing called ideal in this scenario. So I think we will go with whatever best suits the client.
Okay. Independent ad tech companies or the duopoly, whose growth is more in interest of agencies?
All their growth are interest of agencies because agencies benefit with more choices. We don't depend on one or two people, right?
Wow, it almost seems that I had sent you the questions. It's all...
Yeah, well. I can read minds. That's the trick.
Connected TV measurement, should it go the TV way or should it go the digital way?
I think let's get regular videos measured first. Connected TV is a little far-fetched today.
Yep. Mobile advertising as a percentage of India's addicts, what do you think the percentage might be by say 2025, 5 years from now?
Yeah, so see, even today, digital advertising is very mobile driven from that perspective because our targeting is mobile driven, not desktop or laptop driven. So for 2026, definitely a 40% is something that I see happening there.
40%?
Yeah, yeah. Then I think kids will be born with mobile. No?
Yeah, yeah. I think most of them already are. I think some of us don't represent that generation, but our kids are... definitely mobile first in their experiences.
Yes.
Yes. Thanks, Preeti. I think quickly moving, I think the next we have Chanan for you. Is over-measurement plaguing digital ad growth amongst traditional marketers?
Actually, where the consumer is going is leading the growth for traditional marketers. Can you hear me now?
Okay, I can hear you now, but we'll move on to the next question. Audience buys on programmatic or impact buys for CPG brands on digital?
Audience buys. Know your audience follow buys. Them.
Good.
Yeah, that's the way it creates the impact. Yeah.
Given how you're seeing digital advertising grow within your company, what is your estimate of, say, 3 to 5 years from now? What percentage of your own marketing dollars might be spent on digital?
60%.
60%. That's very, very promising. I'm sure if you're spending 60%, then the ADEX will reach more than 50% sooner than what Rajiv and Preeti forecast, and if we have more marketeers like that.
It depends on who your consumer is, right?
I think
it's a lot dependent on that.
Yep. Digitally first brands or established legacy brands, who do you think will rule CPG 5 years from now?
I think premium categories, digital first, but legacy categories, the old established brands.
Good. Very relevant answer. I would tend to agree with that. But my agreeing doesn't guarantee you the hamper. I think we'll go in with the others. Thank you
so
much.
I'm spending all my money on digital. I need the hamper.
Yeah. Oh, that's you've just increased your chances. Bharat, over to you for the next set of questions, the next 4 or 5 questions coming to you.
Sure.
Open RTB based audience buying or programmatic guaranteed based publisher buying? What do you think is the ideal programmatic strategy?
Depend on the campaign objective. If it's lower funnel, open RTB with brand safe tools. If it's more of top of the funnel, middle funnel, then the guaranteed buy.
Cool, very good. Data ownership for the advertiser, agency, or the platform who's delivering the ad?
Advertiser.
Advertiser, not within the, residing within the duopoly walled gardens.
Yeah, the way data regulations are changing, I think if the power lie in the hands of consumer, both consumer and brand to do a handshake on what type of data they want to share with each other and how the brand can reap benefits in terms of making advertising more welcome by showing meaningful ads.
Programmatic advertising, better for brand building or for performance advertising?
Both. It's all about automation of buying, nothing connected to, it can be a full funnel objective.
Correct. It's all about using Zaxxis and all your objectives will be met.
I wish.
Last question. DSP, DMP, SSP, trading desk. Which of these programmatic business models do you see thriving for, say, the next 3 years?
Outcome-driven business models will thrive. Companies who can promise certain relevant, meaningful outcomes which are more closer to business, not just media. I think that will thrive and grow in the next 3 years.
Good. So I think all of them are working towards outcomes. So hopefully all should thrive. We'll all have a job to do.
Definitely.
Good. Thanks so much, Bharat. I think just in the nick of time, Bhavna, over to you. Back to you. We started with you and we're ending with you. So.
Sure.
Ad viewability or ad fraud, what is plaguing the digital industry more today?
I think it's both. Going with what's happening in the current universe, it's actually both of them which are really plaguing us, and we need to find answers for them, as well as measurability.
Okay. Next question. Drive to store or drive to app? What is better as campaign strategies for retail brands like yourselves?
Drive to store. Again, on app, it is have a fixed list. On store, when you touch and feel the products, you can actually decide to pick up more things. And it's more of a shopping expedition rather than having a quick list of, okay, these are the 5 items I need in my cart and let me order them now. So impulse purchase is more on the store.
Agree or disagree, you have to say. Online audience persona-based targeting is good for online brands, whereas proximity and offline habit-based targeting is better for offline brands. Agree or disagree?
Can you repeat? There was just too many, there were too many clauses in this.
Okay, I'll repeat it. online persona based, basically what people are doing online, their online habits, using that as a targeting strategy is ideal for online first brands. Whereas for the offline brands, proximity targeting and location based intelligence is ideal.
I think in terms of retail proximity, things will be there, but agree.
Cool. I think one last question for you, Bhavna, I think which has been asked to others. Digital advertising percentage share of the ADEX, what do you see it happening in the next 5 years?
Okay, given that 2015, none of us got the 2020 answer, right? I don't know how far we will be able to predict it. But I would say it would be around 40 to 50%, 40, 45%. And I'm counting that there will be digital screens and stuff like that also coming in.
The crystal ball is still shining, so I'm going to wait for the ball to hold and see.
Correct.
Please
play this video 5 years from now. We'll all know which one of us got it right. I would put a stamp there and I would say that it's not, I believe that personally it will be much faster. It will not wait to 2025. I think we'll cross 50%, maybe 23 or 24, given the way things are evolving right now. But I think it's been very, very nice having all of you on the panel and being put under the spotlight for these quick answers. I hope you enjoyed it. In case you are curious around who's the winner, I'll reserve my answer. Maybe all of you was to get it. But very, very nice. Thank you so much. I think it's been a very, very fun panel having all of you sharing your points of views around various parts within what's happening within the industry and trends which we are foreseeing. I think we had to go quicker because I was getting messages that we needed to end by 5:10. We are still 5 minutes over, but I don't think too much. We got 10 minutes less when we started. So anyway, good show. And thank you so much, everyone. And look forward to staying connected and watching this video later and trying to see whose predictions came right.